Good morning. Welcome to the second annual Distinguished Faculty Award presentation. It's my pleasure to welcome faculty, staff, students, visitors, and friends of Salt Lake Community College, and particularly of Professor Katherine McIntyre. Kathy has spent a number of months in preparation for this exciting day, and we're delighted to have you here with us. We realize that classes have just let out, and we will have folks continuing to come in, so hope you folks will move over and allow people plenty of room to come into the room as they're arriving. We will continue with the program as outlined, and I'd like to turn the time now over to Dr. Frank Budd, president of Salt Lake Community College, for some remarks.
Well, good morning. I would like to say good morning to all of our friends and colleagues and students who are in attendance here this morning, as well as through means of technology at some of our other sites. I think we all need to recognize that this morning is a very noteworthy occasion for Salt Lake Community College. We are maturing as an institution and becoming increasingly recognized as a legitimate partner in the scope of higher education in the state of Utah. The richness of our history and tradition is only beginning to unfold. And as we take our rightful place as a significant force in the community and the state, it is appropriate that we establish our own traditions, traditions which recognize and celebrate the intellectual and educational quality of Salt Lake Community College. The annual Distinguished Faculty Lecture has been added to other traditions we are building here at the college, all, I hope, in support of our values and our business of teaching and learning. Last year's first faculty lecture, delivered by Terry Martin, was an excellent choice to lead off in this tradition, and certainly this year's selection is no less exciting. Kathy McIntyre is an excellent choice. She's an outstanding faculty member of Salt Lake Community College, and I'm sure that her presentation today will continue to build on this celebration of teaching. I appreciate personally your attendance here this morning, and I'm certain you will be richly rewarded for your presence here today. And that's all I'm going to say, because this show is not about me. So thank you very much.
Morning. It's my privilege this morning to introduce Professor Kathy McIntyre, who is, you know, is this year's distinguished faculty member. Kathy works in our school, and we enjoy our association with her. Kathy's had a wide variety of professional experiences over the years. I'm going to go through a few of the highlights, by no means covering them all. She was a Fulbright consultant to Algeria, where she spent 2 years teaching, teaching English as a second language. She was a Peace Corps volunteer and taught English in Tunisia for 2 years. She's been a frequent teacher trainer for the U.S. government and has consulted and taught in a variety of countries, such as Czechoslovakia, Poland, Morocco, Syria, and Turkey. Her primary responsibilities while in these countries was to teach teachers the techniques for teaching English. She came to SLCC 13 years ago in the winter quarter of 1983 and has been a faculty member here teaching English as a second language ever since. She has a Bachelor of Arts degree in English, a Master of Arts degree in English Linguistics. And last year, she completed a sabbatical leave, and during which time she updated her teaching and writing skills with an emphasis on English as a second language. In her personal life, she enjoys skiing, hiking, climbing mountains, gardening, and traveling. Kathy told me the other day that, quote, she likes to take on new challenges to improve her teaching and her students' learning, unquote. And today, she'll discuss the role of classroom research here at SLCC. She will describe her own research techniques and methodology, as well as those of some of her colleagues, and explain how they conduct research in their own classrooms. Her constant attention to improving her pedagogical techniques through introspection, acquiring new teaching and learning skills, and developing classroom research methodology are reflected in the title of her presentation, What Are We Doing Here Anyway? It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor McIntyre.
There's a video section too. We're going to start the presentation with a short video segment of some of the other faculty at the college talking.
The community college is a teaching institution. Our main focus is in teaching the students, teaching and learning. And you cannot improve teaching and learning without research. I mean, everything you do to improve, everything you do to evaluate how well you're teaching, how well the students are learning is research. You take this data that you've gained from their grades, from their input, from your student evaluations, from your other colleagues, and you combine it into something meaningful, and then you use that to improve your teaching. So all of that, you can't improve without research. You can't develop new programs. You can't develop better ways to do things, better teaching methods. You can't use the new technology without doing research on it. I think when they say we're not a research institution, okay, we don't do medical research for some business, or we don't go out and say, hey, industry people, I'm going to show you a new way to design things, but we do research on teaching because we're a teaching institution.
I do classroom research. I like doing classroom research because I feel like it gives me more information, more accurate information than group testing and trying to assess what's going on in the classroom by using standardized evaluations and testing methods.
My idea of faculty doing research, and I must remind you, I'm a technical instructor. I normally think of research as finding of a solution to a certain problem, taking a problem and researching or exploring different ways to approach and hopefully solve the problem. So basically, that's my idea of research. Sometimes it's many answers, sometimes it's one answer. Approach with different methods. Okay, that would about be my idea of research here. Now, I know that other institutions that are research schools, that is a very small part of their area. Their idea of research goes into extremely high-tech and fields that I have very little knowledge of. But in my views, as a technical instructor, research means finding an answer to a problem in a scientific or a logical manner. Could be any problem that approaches the community college education level. It might be an education problem. It might be a maybe even supply. Any problem that would stop a teacher from effectively doing a job is what I would consider doing research to help him do a job or help him or her do a job better.
Well, I believe that anyone who teaches anything does research. I think it's a matter of semantics. They say, well, I do this and I do that, and another person would say, well, that's research. Well, gee, I didn't think it was research. I was just trying to keep up to date. It's so simple when you look at really what you have to do, any teacher has to do to stay a good teacher. You have to ask questions, you have to talk to people about things, you have to get out of your little comfort zone and be willing to ask the questions of other people. We all do research. Life is research.
I mean, when I think of it in my own head, I'm not doing classroom research. What I'm doing is trying to be the best teacher I can be, which means I'm trying to figure out what's getting through to students, what they need, what they want to be doing.
I just think that's so important, such an integral part of the teaching process. The big issue, we attended the conference yesterday, and the big issue was that they talked about was accountability. We're going to be called on the carpet for accountability, and how do you prove that? How can you show you're being accountable if you have no data? And we can say, we can look at graduates, and we can look at retention, all those kinds of things, but as far as what happens in the individual classroom, you never know until you actually do some studies, some research.
I don't know very many teachers who aren't alert to the multitude of signs that something's either going well or not. I don't know that it's our job at the college. It's not listed in the job description, but I don't know how we can keep teaching quarter after quarter without asking our students some questions about how our teaching methods are affecting them and what they're learning from us. I go back to the notion that if nothing's been learned, nothing's been taught. I mean, teaching is not a one-way process. It hasn't happened just because we said something or did something. So we ought to be interested in what students are learning.
And you might call this informal research. And I think this is important to stress, that you know, research is a problematic term in our society. Research with a capital R is the kind of research that people kind of get grants to do. And it's important to understand that teachers are researchers all the time. If you keep a journal and begin to note and track and process what students are doing in the classroom, you're doing a form of research. It may not be a kind of research that has a lot of legitimacy in the sort of elitist hierarchy of the world of research, but it's research nevertheless.
What are we doing here anyway? What are you doing here? What am I doing here? What are we supposed to be doing? And what are we actually doing? We are all teaching, and we are all learning. For some of us, the priority is teaching. For others, the priority is learning. But to a certain extent, we are all doing both, teaching and learning. We're trying to do the best possible job of teaching and learning. But how do we know if we're succeeding? How do we know if our teaching and learning are successful? How do we know what improvements or changes need to be made? Well, students pass our courses, they graduate, they get jobs, or they continue on for a bachelor's degree, a master's, even a PhD. If they get jobs, they do their jobs well and even get promotions. If they continue on at another school, they do well in their courses. Seems like we're doing something right. But what is it that we're doing right? And could we be doing better? Are we teaching if our students aren't learning? Are we teaching if we aren't also learning? Are the students learning what we think they're learning? I hope that none of us is conceited enough to think that we couldn't do a better job of teaching. But before we can figure out how to do a better job, we must first understand what is already happening. I teach English as a second language, ESL. As an ESL teacher, I am constantly learning. I'm learning about my discipline, although there haven't really been any major changes in the English language in the 20 years that I've been teaching it. I'm luckier than many of my colleagues in this respect. Some of your fields are changing daily, almost by the minute. I'm also learning how to transmit my discipline more effectively to my students. And in this endeavor, my students are my primary teachers. They show me in many ways what works and what doesn't work. They challenge me to clarify my objectives, to refine my teaching methods, and to rethink my theoretical foundations. Within the system of American higher education, the distinction is often made between research institutions and teaching institutions. I believe that this distinction is very misleading because faculty at teaching institutions not only do research, but must do research if they are to offer quality teaching. It is true that Salt Lake Community College is not a research institution like the University of Utah or Brigham Young University. I know colleagues at both of these institutions, and I know that they view their jobs quite differently than I view mine. Here at the college, we don't get major grants to do detailed research projects and develop new theories or make new discoveries. It isn't part of our job description to publish scholarly articles and books and to present at professional conferences. We teach 15 to 25 hours per week and don't often get release time to conduct research. And yet, I have come to realize in the past 6 months that all of us at Salt Lake Community College are engaged in various forms of research every day, sometimes formally, but more often informally. Responses to a faculty survey I conducted last fall quarter indicate that the faculty here routinely and systematically investigate their teaching practices and make changes based on both oral and written feedback from their students, from colleagues, from people in business and industry, and others. And in interviews with some of the faculty, I found that many of us have developed highly effective and reliable methods for getting feedback. We don't always call it research, but as Stephen Rufus just said, it is research nevertheless. There are lots of different ways to describe and define the kind of research we are doing. Sometimes it's called action research, sometimes exploratory teaching, sometimes classroom inquiry, or classroom investigation, or classroom assessment, or teacher research, or participatory research, or participatory education, or simply problem solving or improving educational quality. I could certainly be better informed about a lot of the literature on research, but I have chosen the term classroom research because it appears to me that it is research done in and around the classroom by the teachers and the students for the improvement of teaching and learning. It is a way of having people draw on their own experiences and their own needs to collaboratively develop problem-solving techniques to create their own curriculum. Here is how some other faculty members have described what we do.
Classroom research is an ongoing project that a teacher undertakes in the classroom to come to some understanding of what students are learning and to provide both the teacher and the students with ongoing feedback as to the nature of that learning.
To me, research is not just gathering data. Research is making sense of the data. And I can collect information from my students. I can ask them for input. I can ask them to, how did you like this class? Which portions of the class were most meaningful? But unless I have some way to use that data to improve my teaching, I haven't really done research. So I would probably define research as getting the information I need and then using it to improve my teaching skills.
I think classroom research has two basic components to it. The first one is a more formalized, a formal component, where we do an official study, like a pre-post test, or you would have an actual survey that you would go through to compare maybe with national statistics or whatever. But I think even a more important component is the informal assessment, which I've tried to do. I've done it for years and years and years, having students evaluate projects, evaluate assignments, evaluate video. The formal research does give you a measure of a particular thing that you're looking at. You can measure if they're increasing on a particular test, let's say. You give them a pre-test, you give them a post-test, you can see what changes have occurred. The informal, I think, is very valuable because you get feedback in terms of how students feel about things, how they feel about the assignments, how they feel about what's going on in the classroom. You get their impressions about what's talked about, are the discussions valuable or not valuable, and gets great suggestions too. I think that's, to me, that's one of the more important things is the suggestions students give.
I would define classroom research as any exploration a teacher undertakes to discover what helps students learn or what they're learning or not learning from the particular methodologies we use in the classroom.
For a long time, research has been a taboo issue for community college faculty. Research was seen as the job of the research institutions, not the community colleges. In fact, when I first started teaching here, I felt very happy that I didn't have to worry about doing research, that I could concentrate on what I love best, teaching. I didn't realize back then that doing research is a part of being a good teacher. Now there's a growing trend to recognize classroom teachers as researchers in their own right. In fact, the call for presentations for this year's 19th annual Utah Community College Conference, which will be held April 7th at the South City campus, asked for papers dealing with the ways classroom research promotes inquiry for college teachers and learners. We are engaged in researching our teaching quality. We are determining our teaching effectiveness, the impact of new methods or new technology on our students. We are experimenting with new approaches to the material that we hope will enhance student learning. We look at outcomes assessment as our students go out into business and industry or on to other academic institutions. In many different ways, obvious and not obvious, we are very much a research institution. We are teachers, we are researchers, we are learners. I've been teaching college preparatory English as a second language at Salt Lake Community College since 1982. Over the years, I have continuously redefined my teaching goals and refined my teaching practices based on feedback from students and colleagues and on input from professional conferences and readings. One of my major goals in all of my classes is to increase the students' understanding of what they need to learn as well as of what they already know. I want to help my students become better learners, not just in my class, but throughout their lives. And one of my major goals in my writing classes is to help them understand that writing is as much a process as it is a product. I want the students to recognize the importance of the context in which and for which a piece of writing was created. From this point of view, it is difficult, if not impossible, to evaluate a piece of writing outside of its context. For several years, I have wanted to find more valid assessment methods that would help me get closer to accomplishing my teaching goals. Experience has taught me that any student who wants to get a decent grade is going to study for the big test, whether or not what is on that test matches either the student's learning goals or the teacher's stated teaching goals. The traditional assessment methods that I was using were not encouraging my students to focus on what they really needed to learn. In the writing class, it seemed to me that when the students received grades on individual papers, they were afraid to take chances and stretch their wings when they were writing. There was also too much focus on the product rather than on the process, even if I tacked on a grade for participation. The use of exams and tests focused too much attention on one time and a few teaching points, rather than on the writing process itself and on students' growth as writers. I wanted to find a better fit between my assessment methods and my teaching goals. While on sabbatical leave last year, I had time to read more about portfolio-based assessment in writing classes. The portfolio concept was already vaguely familiar to me. I had tried to use a similar approach already in my classes. But as I read, I began to see changes I could make that might get my students and myself working more towards my teaching goals. So I designed a system of portfolio-based assessment for my ESL writing class. Each student would prepare an ungraded practice portfolio at midterm, and then a final graded portfolio at the end of the quarter. The student would select items for the portfolio that showed both his or her progress as a writer during the quarter and the quality of that writing at the end of the quarter. The portfolio would also include the student's explanation for why these particular items had been selected for the portfolio and what the selections showed about the student's understanding of what he or she had learned. But how would I know if this new approach to assessment was really helping me accomplish my goals? How would I know if my students understood why we were trying such a radically different assessment system? How would I know if they liked it? This is the type of question we all pursue all the time as we try to improve our teaching. A research project was born when I attempted to answer these questions for myself and for my colleagues at the college, who were thinking about using portfolio-based assessment. The research is still in progress, but based on feedback from my students during the past fall and winter quarters, the new method of assessment has been at least partially successful, successful enough for me to continue to refine it and continue to use it. Here is how some of the students from fall quarter understood the purpose of portfolio grading when I interviewed them after the quarter was over.
The first I heard about portfolio, I couldn't understand what the purpose, what the meaning. Mm-hmm. Because usually, the teacher graded us using test, mm-hmm. Participation. Mm-hmm. But I've never, taken that system, so just confused. Mm-hmm. But after some explanation and like question answer, I could understand. Mm-hmm. After I've done the midterm portfolio, I was so surprised, because before the portfolio, midterm portfolio, I didn't want to relate my writing. Just I wrote, that's finished. Mm-hmm. I've never reread my writing, so that means I had no chance to know about my improvement. The midterm portfolio gave me a chance to know myself, my writing. Mm-hmm. So it was satisfied. Mm-hmm. I'm really satisfied.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I think that maybe because you try to let us know for ourselves what we learned in that quarter. I saw how I improved my writing as my first writing assignment and the last one.
I understood about the purpose, so that was to show you, teacher, my improvement so far at the time. So I picked up the worst one and the middle one, like a little bit better one, and the best one so far. So to show you how can I improve.
It's more comfortable than when you have test last day in the quarter. You get in test, maybe you don't do well, and you lose all what you did in the quarter in one day. Mm-hmm. But if you have a portfolio, you will show your work during your quarter.
I believe all teachers are researchers by nature. Research is, in fact, a practical part of our daily working lives. Not only at Salt Lake Community College, but at community colleges throughout the country, there is a diverse and expanding group of teachers who are learning to investigate their teaching and their classrooms as a way to develop a better understanding of the teaching practice, to improve professional skills, to contribute useful knowledge and experience to the teaching profession, and to provide accountability for our actions. Teachers can be just as successful as professional researchers if they know where and how to search. We are ideally situated in the classroom to investigate what is happening. Our investigation might either reinforce what we already know intuitively or provide new insight and new understanding about student learning. Either way, whether it confirms our expectations or it provides us with surprises, research makes us better teachers, which means we serve our students better. So, how do we do it?
There's really no mystery to it. It's just a matter of coming into the classroom, thinking of yourself also as a researcher in at least some ways, mm-hmm. a researcher in the sense that you're here not only to teach, but you're here to find out what students are learning.
Informal is done in a couple of ways. One, in every class, at the end of the quarter, I give them a little informal survey. It's a part of their student packet. And they fill that out and turn it in. They don't have to put their names on or anything. And it asks them to rate every assignment we do, every exercise we do, in terms of if it's hard or easy, and in terms of its value. And then also, I have them on that form make any comments, write any comments they'd like to make. And I've done that for a number of years, and I've gotten some really good feedback from students in terms of that. I've also done some more formalized research in looking at test scores, pre and post kinds of things. But most of the stuff I do in my classes now, because they're really not the kind that lend themselves to real formal structure, is mostly informal. And a lot of what I get from students, just talking to them after class, before class, we'll do something and I'll ask them just informally, how do you feel about the situation? How do you feel about what we did? And get some feedback. That's always very helpful.
I use informal as well as formal type methods. Informally, I ask the students for feedback on a regular basis concerning the activities that we carry out in class. Anytime we complete an activity, we have a little session at the end of that activity where we evaluate why it was valuable or why it wasn't valuable and what the students liked about it or what they felt uncomfortable about. And then formally, at the end of each quarter, I have my students answer questionnaires that give me information about the types of or the different learning activities that we participate in during the quarter. I have them tell me what they felt helped them learn the most. I also ask them to rate all the activities we do in our classroom, trying to identify those that they feel are most valuable to their education process and the ones that are least valuable to their education process. And then I don't do the ones that are least valuable mm-hmm. again, and I try something different. We're always observing what students are doing, mm-hmm. and observation is a very good way of assessing what is going on in the classroom and being able to identify processes that are going on.
Well, I may be shooting for the big piece here. I like qualitative research very much. I think students are capable of describing their experience. I don't always feel a need for my classroom and to satisfy my need to know how students are doing, to be able to quantify what's going on. I feel like from what students write about their experience or what they say about their experience, I get very accurate feedback. So there's this fine line in that research between pursuing what appears to be a profitable avenue based on theoretical things that you've come across or based on your own best theory and observation and checking that out with students along the way, but I think sometimes we may give up prematurely because it takes a long time for them to experience the benefit of what you've done. And I don't like to pronounce the death before the patient is dead. But I think the major factors for me are generating the questions among colleagues. That's the most fruitful seedbed for me as we talk about what we do in classrooms. And that may be a piece of it too, is my general experience is that if we aren't careful, teachers often isolate themselves. It's me and my students. On the days that things go well, I feel wonderful. On the days they go terrible, I feel like a complete failure, and I don't talk about that. Mm-hmm. And some of the best experiences I've ever had are on the days when it all fell apart and then you talk to somebody about it.
In addition to coming up with a lesson plan beforehand of what I'm going to do, then I try to do a post-lesson plan, which is what did I learn from the students that I need to strengthen? What parts seem to not, you know, were hit and miss kinds of things? And so therefore, what could I come up with that might get them more involved? I mean, I guess my classroom research is trying to find out for them where the lack of connections are so I can help them make those, and also to find out what connections they are making that I can help them explore.
The feedback that we get that helps us to feel like we're doing a good job, which is the bottom line, is that the students are going out and getting jobs. That's almost the bottom line. even more bottom line than that is, are they taking care of the patients? Because that truly is the bottom line. And the feedback that we get from our physician advisors, from all of the doctor's offices, is that they think our students are very, very well trained, very professional, have very good technical skills, and especially from an entry level. And so we, again, we go to the source.
If you're doing your job, you're doing classroom research. Whether you realize it or not, put a different name on it, if you are keeping track of technology, you are doing classroom research. Whether the person realizes it or admits it or whatever, if you're not doing your job or you're not keeping track of the times, then you're probably not doing classroom research. Most teachers, I think, would have to say, at least in maybe smaller methods or methods that they're not calling research, I think they really are doing research.
So what is it that teachers need to know? What are they interested in knowing? How do they find out what they need to know? It often seems that the more we know, the less we know, and so the more we need to know. In an interview with Bill Tanner from the biology department, he described teachers as organisms with biochemical pathways. We get positive and negative feedback. We know when things are working or not working, and we respond automatically, kind of like a plant, I guess. We get this positive and negative feedback informally in several ways. We look at the students' faces and decide if they look asleep or awake, bored or interesting, confused or clear. We try to read their minds. We listen to students' questions and decide if they seem to be on track or totally off the wall. But that doesn't usually tell us why they're off the wall or why they're on track. We look at class attendance. Are they coming to class? If not, why not? If they are, what is the relationship, if any, between their attendance and our teaching? We also listen to students' comments before and during and after class. We eavesdrop. Are they complaining? Are they asking each other a lot of questions about the class rather than asking us, the teacher? Are they clearly surprised or clearly dismayed with test results? After class, we mull over how the lesson went. We know how we feel about it, but we don't always know how the students feel. We look at our students' test results, at their papers and projects, and try to decide what combination of our teaching and the students' learning produce these results. This is often unfair to students because it affects their grades. We also describe a situation to a colleague and ask for feedback, but the colleague is obviously getting secondhand, subjective, selective information and may not be able to provide us with objective feedback. There's nothing wrong with these methods. They can be quite effective. But how can we formalize the procedure? How can we get more usable and accurate feedback? In classroom research, we learn something by collecting data. We try to make some sense of it through analysis. Then we go back and see if our interpretation makes sense in light of new experience by collecting more data. Then we refine our interpretation with more analysis. The process is not linear. It involves constant rethinking, reviewing, redefining, reanalyzing. Before I get into an explanation of research design, I'd like to make explicit four assumptions that I have that form the theoretical foundations for both my teaching and my classroom research. The first assumption is that while learning can and often does take place without teaching, I don't believe there can be effective teaching if no learning is taking place. The quality of student learning is directly, though not exclusively, related to the quality of teaching. We need a constant flow of accurate information on student learning in order to be able to assess our teaching. Research on instructional effectiveness, on the outcomes of teaching, is extremely important in improving the quality of instruction. How do you know what to change if you don't know how you're doing? The second assumption is that before you can evaluate your students' learning or your own teaching, you need to be able to clearly identify what you are trying to teach. How do you know if you're succeeding if you don't know what you are trying to do? How do you know how far off track you are or how to get back on track? The third assumption is that research that is done by individual teachers in response to questions or concerns they have about their own teaching is more likely to improve teaching, and therefore learning, than research that comes to them from outside the classroom. We learn best when what we are learning is directly relevant and useful to us. Portfolio-based assessment, and even the concept of classroom research, didn't mean much to me until I had a need for them and began to see how they could help me meet that need. The fourth assumption is that all teachers constantly assess their teaching performance in one way or another. These assumptions were taken from, adapted from the book Classroom Assessment Techniques by Thomas Angelo and Pat Cross. We all have our musings. I wonder what the students really thought about that activity. I wonder how much they really learned. I wonder if this is really the most effective method. I wonder if that would work with my students. Sometimes we pursue those musings. Again and again, as I talk to my colleagues, I found them using creative, simple, effective methods to get answers to these questions they had. Here are the stages I went through in my research process as I started using portfolio-based assessment. I began by observing my classroom. I was also influenced by readings and conference sessions. Based on these observations, on ideas from outside sources, and on a class I was taking at the university, I focused on the issue of assessing writing. Next, I wrote down some questions I wanted to answer to clarify for myself what I wanted to know. It can also be helpful to involve the students from the start, change the power structure, ask them the questions, and see if they have any answers or if they have any questions themselves. See if it is a profitable line of inquiry or if it might be too broad, too specific, or too undefined. Unfortunately, since I was on sabbatical when I was doing my research design, I didn't have access to the students as I was planning, but I brought them in as co-researchers as soon as the classes began. When I started the portfolio project, I had the following questions. First, what happened when we implemented portfolio-based assessment? Second, what were the students' attitudes towards this new type of assessment? Did they like it? Third, what were my attitudes towards this type of assessment? Fourth, how do these two groups of attitudes, mine and the students, compare to each other? And fifth, what does all this tell us about the way we are using portfolio assessment in the ESL writing class? Should we continue doing it? Should we make changes in it? Should we try something else? I was also working on two other broader questions as part of the Distinguished Lecture Project, and those were, what do classroom researchers at Salt Lake Community College do? What is it like to be a researcher here? The second stage of my research was to develop a research design, a strategy for getting answers to the questions. Based on the students, the type of class, etc., what is the most reliable, effective, efficient, and fair way to collect information? In the portfolio-based assessment project, I knew that my students were not likely to openly express any negative ideas. They'd probably basically tell me what they thought I wanted to hear, unless their answers were anonymous. So we used a lot of quick, anonymous surveys, what we called no-name quizzes, to find out what they understood and how they felt. Also, Because it was a writing class, I could easily incorporate introspective techniques into their journal writing assignments and later analyze their reactions. We also had a lot of classroom discussions and one-on-one interviews to gather data about student reactions. And a colleague came in and interviewed the class about portfolios without me being there. She genuinely wanted to get some ideas about using portfolios, and we hoped that the students would see her as more impartial, less invested in portfolio-based assessment than I was, and so be more open with their responses. She asked them to explain portfolios to her and to tell her if she should use them in her class, too. If she should, why should she? If she shouldn't, why not? What changes should be made? The third stage was to implement the research project. I taught the class. I used a variety of data collection techniques. I collected the data. It sounds short and simple, but this part was really very time-consuming and complex. In the fourth stage, I analyzed the data. I looked over my notes again and again, looking for trends, trying to understand what it was telling me, if anything. I looked for gaps, for discrepancies, for reinforcement. I discussed my findings with the students whenever possible. I got their help with the analysis. They provided valuable insight and fresh new perspectives. Of course, the students didn't all agree with each other or with me, and the ensuing dialogue was very beneficial to the analysis. Through the data analysis, I discovered several problems with the use of portfolios in the ESL writing class. I hadn't really anticipated the first problem we encountered when we started using portfolios. The students had a lot of difficulty understanding what they were supposed to do for the portfolios and why we were using portfolios as opposed to the traditional assessment methods. It took a while, but after several explanations and question and answer sessions, most of them seemed to understand by the time they submitted their midterm portfolios. Another problem was how the students felt about using portfolios. I was afraid they wouldn't like the system because it was so different from anything they'd done before. And there was a lot of confusion and grumbling throughout the first quarter. However, on a survey which the students completed after they had received their final grades for fall quarter, 16 of the 19 students said they liked the portfolio grading system, 2 had no opinion, and only 1 said he did not like it. So once they had been through the complete experience, the majority of the students seemed to be supportive of the portfolio-based assessment system I had devised. At midterm this quarter, the students have been divided about 50-50 between those who like the system and those who don't. We'll see if any have changed their minds at the end of the quarter. I was also worried about grade inflation, since the students could redo their papers as many times as they wanted to, and they could choose which papers to submit in their portfolios. The range of grades at the end of the first quarter was fairly wide, 7 A's, 5 B's, 3 C's, 3 extensions, and 3 students who dropped out during the quarter. While there were perhaps more A's than in any previous quarter, the students who received them had made truly impressive improvements in their writing, and they are now doing excellent work in their current writing classes, both English 90 and English 99. Furthermore, 2 students who dropped out during the first quarter opted to take my class again this quarter, when there were 3 other choices of ESL writing classes. I thought they had been scared away, but they assured me that they wanted to take the class with me again because they liked the new grading system. Based on survey results, the final portfolios, and discussions with students during and after fall quarter, there was a definite improvement in the students' attitudes and understanding of writing. Furthermore, I have felt that we are coming closer to meeting my teaching goals, so I'm satisfied enough to continue to use portfolio-based assessment with some modifications. The fifth stage of my research was to organize the information into a usable form. I looked over the data and the analysis, then I redid lesson plans and class handouts. I asked the students for their suggestions for change. I told them what I had learned from them and what changes I thought I ought to make based on what they had told me. The final stage was to implement the changes this quarter. It's important to remember that this process is not linear. At many stages in the research, I went back to a previous stage. I reframed the questions based on the results of data collection and analysis. I redesigned the research project in light of incoming data. I reobserved the class and redesigned the portfolios. Let me describe some data collection techniques that I found useful and that other faculty here at Salt Lake Community College have reported using. Research usually begins with observation of our classroom. As researchers, we need to try to take ourselves out of the context, to view the scene as an objective stranger, to see it in a new light. Too often, we become blind to what is actually happening in our classrooms because it is so familiar to us. I watched the students and observed their level of involvement. I looked for changes. I tried to see a relationship between my teaching goals and my classroom practices. Larry Barlage from Automotive reported that his students used to fall asleep during his lectures, but now that he has incorporated new technology in his presentations, they stay awake. That's important information about the value of the new technology. Observation is useful by itself, but it is much more effective when it is combined with a teaching journal. Then it can become much more like reflective teaching. During my project, I kept a research log in which I wrote about what happened in class, what reactions I had or the students had, what questions they asked, how long activities took, how something worked or didn't work, any kind of information that might tell me something about what was going on. Got my pages out of order here. Where did I put those? Okay. Annotated lesson plans can also be an effective research tool. As Helen mentioned, it is often helpful to just jot down notes to yourself on the lesson plan to help you remember as you are planning the next class or the next quarter. I do this right away after, or sometimes even during, every lesson, so I'll remember what changes I need to make. These notes can also provide information on differences between quarters, on the value and effectiveness of certain activities, and on how long some activity really takes. Discussion with colleagues. In addition to discoveries we make when we try to see our classrooms with new eyes, colleagues can provide a lot of good insight and ideas on our teaching. As Linda said, discussion with colleagues can be very fruitful. It's important that we not isolate ourselves in our classrooms. One of the most valuable sources of information for me has been when I have asked colleagues to come in and observe my class, especially some aspect of it, and tell me what they see happening. I also often talk to colleagues after class and analyze a particular situation or talk over a new idea. Sometimes just by talking about it, I get a clearer idea, but more often, colleagues have some very helpful suggestions. Feedback from business and industry, from the PACs, the program advisory committees, and from the community is especially important in the applied technology areas. The faculty I interviewed from these areas said they communicate regularly with people out in industry and with their program advisory committees, and they rely heavily on input from these sources when they're making changes in their curriculum. Student records can also provide a lot of useful information. Many teachers here collect demographic information on their students so they can get a clearer picture of their classroom community. Others find it helpful to keep track of grades for several quarters so they can spot trends and changes that may be significant. These records are also absolutely necessary when we are asked to account for our teaching for accreditation or funding purposes. Professional magazines and conferences are an absolutely essential source of new information for faculty at the college. Outside sources regularly direct and influence our teaching. We get new ideas from reading, from conference sessions, and from talking to colleagues. Individual investigation of what is happening in one's own classroom is often combined with a search for relevant written information. It is extremely helpful to learn about and from the experiences of others. There is also a need for communication and support from colleagues, community services, institutional and professional networks, databases. We don't work in a vacuum. But probably the most important source of information is the students themselves. Student feedback might take the form of class discussions about the value or purposes for certain learning activities. Student journals in which the students reflect on classroom activities can provide some useful information. And surveys taken before, during, and at the end of the quarter to find out how the students are reacting are used by many, many of the faculty here. Here is an example of a survey which Jerry Giles conducts with the students in his LE 135 classes at the end of the quarter. On this survey, he asks them to rate the ease of doing and the value of doing the various classroom activities. He then uses the results of the survey to make changes in the course. He reported that he has received some very important feedback from his students that have led to substantial changes and hopefully improvements in the course. Casual conversation with students frequently provides surprising and important information. Talking to graduates who are working in the field or who have gone to other schools may provide information about the value of what is being taught here at the college. And Cross and Angelo, in their book, I don't know if you can see it from there, Classroom Assessment Techniques, suggest over 50 different ways to get feedback about student learning. I used one of these techniques as part of my research on portfolio-based assessment in my ESL writing class. Because I was using portfolio-based assessment for the first time, I wanted to know how much the students understood from my explanation of how they would be graded. When we began, the students told me they were totally unfamiliar with the concept of portfolio-based assessment. So I used the classroom assessment technique that is known as the minute paper, only we took 5 minutes to do it. On class, I distributed the syllabus with the explanation of the portfolio grading system, and we discussed it. 1 week later, I handed out little slips of paper and wrote the following question on the board. What is a portfolio, and what percent of your grade in this class will be based on the portfolio? I told them not to write their names on the papers and not to look in their syllabi or notes. I gave them 5 minutes to write their answers. Out of 22 responses, 14 understood and remembered that a portfolio is a collection of their writings from the class. 8 didn't seem to have any idea what a portfolio is. 5 understood and remembered that it would be 75% of their grade in the class. 17 didn't know what percentage it would be. I told the students how many of them had understood correctly. Our analysis was that too many of them still apparently did not understand how they were to be graded in the class. They asked me to go over the syllabus with them again and explain the grading system again. So I did. The adult learning classroom is premised on the active role of learners in their own learning and the basing of curricula on the needs of learners. When students regularly engage in research activities, they begin to take responsibility for their own learning.
I think it is absolutely critical to involve students in their own education. In an excellent teaching environment, I come away feeling like I have learned every bit as much as my students have. I have the background, the resources that perhaps they don't have in my special area, but they have resources and background as human beings from different perspectives that I don't have, and I think it's a shared venture.
When I think of qualitative research, I think of research that relies on students' self-reports about what's happening with them as opposed to research that relies on some statistical device that purports to measure in a more objective sense what's going on for students in terms of learning. And I know that qualitative research had a hard time getting established for that very reason, because it seems so subjective.
I think assessment at a community college is particularly important, because our entire character, in a sense, is predicated on what we do in the classroom. Our success is and should be measured in terms of outcomes.
Do it. It's very rewarding and it's really helpful. Students feel valued when you look to them to give you information about teaching and learning. I'm trusting that they can direct their learning and that they can be in charge of their learning. And by reading and seeing what they have recorded in their portfolio, it's validating what I thought, that students are capable of being in charge of their learning. And yes, learning does take place, and I might not have all the best answers about what that student needs to prepare to become a good teacher.
Mm-hmm. I think that make me feel more something like important, because at that time we were making something new, something different, and I thought that we will just try to do our best, and in that way we will show how important was the portfolio for us.
I feel kind of exciting to be part of this research, so I can give my opinions. Maybe with my opinion, I can help somebody who need it. Mm-hmm.
An approach to classroom research that involves a dialogue between teachers and students increases the awareness of students as equal partners with their teachers in an open-ended relationship. The dialogue between researcher and researched can create new possibilities for the learning, growth, and transformation of all who participate in the dialogue. The idea of learning in community with others is at the heart of incorporating dialogue in research. By engaging in these methods of research, teachers can learn more about their students and about themselves. Over Christmas vacation this year, I read a book called Give Me My Father's Bones by Ken Harper. It is the story of Minik, an Eskimo boy who was brought to New York City at the end of the 19th century by Robert Peary, a well-known Arctic explorer, so that the anthropologists at the American Museum of Natural History could do research on the Eskimos in comfort. Once the researchers had gotten the information they wanted, Minik was basically left to fend for himself in New York City. After many difficult years, he finally was able to return to his home in the Arctic, only to discover that he no longer fit in there, and he returned to the U.S. a sad and lonely person. It is my strong, strong hope that researchers are no longer treating their research subjects in this manner. It is especially important that as teacher researchers, we recognize our responsibility to our research subjects, and that we work as a team rather than as impartial observers. On the other hand, it is also necessary to be at least a bit cautious about feedback from students. Students don't have the broad perspective that most teachers have. They aren't aware, and it isn't their job to be aware, of theories of teaching and learning. Students have their own agendas that can interfere with their ability to be objective.
That students can be very resistant to our efforts to change a course, a change in methodology, a change in the course content, or whatever. And if we were to rely solely on student reports of their experience with a new methodology, for instance, I think we could be led astray. And I think the course that I worked on is a case in point. Students out there truly believe, because we've taught them well to believe it, that grammar is sort of like a medicinal thing. You know, it's like cod liver oil. If you take a grammar course every now and then and just nail those grammar rules, it's going to be good for you. And so when we tried to take that away from them and say, I think I have a better way to help you improve your writing and become, you know, a stronger writer, to say what you have to say more clearly, etc., they were very resistant. And in fact, my experience in this past fall quarter was I had certain students resisting full out until well after the midterm. and then saying, I wish I'd withdrawn from this class. And then I would say, why would you want to do that? You've been here for 5 weeks. You've been working so hard. Why don't you just complete the course? So I think it is an important issue that we can't always rely on students' sense of what they need, because we've taught them what they need before they come here.
Michael Agar, in his book, The Professional Stranger, An Informal Introduction to Ethnography, says the researcher should always be aware of who his or her informants are. The first people to approach the teacher-researcher are often the people who are on the edge of the group. The teacher represents a potential resource that these people might control to gain status or recognition. Furthermore, you may have noticed that most classes seem to have an official or unofficial spokesperson. Agar calls them the professional stranger handlers, to deal with teachers. Imagine the picture of community life you would get just by talking to its outsiders and its public relations experts. The picture that we get from these students in our class might be representative of the class as a whole, but one should get some information from the regulars to verify that. To get the most accurate and reliable feedback from students, first, make sure that you get feedback from all different sections of the classroom community. Next, make sure that they are in a position to inform, that they have enough time and experience to be able to form a reasonable opinion. Try to get as much feedback as possible. Get feedback during different parts of the quarter and during several quarters before you make changes. And most important, make sure that the students' grades will not in any way be affected by the feedback they provide. Teachers who engage in classroom research report that the process is one of experimentation and evolution. Classroom researchers adapt the forms and purposes of research to meet the needs of their own classrooms and their own students. But if we want to improve the quality of our teaching through classroom research, we first need to recognize that research is an essential part of what we do. I need to value my own research. You students need to understand and value your role in the research we do. Colleagues need to be interested in, to value, and to support each other's research. And the institution and the community need to recognize the importance of research at a teaching institution. We could use help with developing research designs, methods, and instruments that will give us the information we need. It would be nice to have someone who could handle statistics and data input for us. Encouragement, dialogue, and feedback would improve the research we are doing, and therefore our teaching and the students' learning. But there's one very important thing that we need in order to do more research to improve the quality of our teaching and our students' learning. My colleagues said it again and again in our interviews.
Oh, time, where art thou? I'm sure it would be good. It's just very difficult. I teach 5 hours a day, and as we all know, anyone that teaches, that is full time. That is just major. And then all of the homework and preparation and all the other things, committee meetings, things that we've got going on, we have to do the research. But I don't know if there's any more time, unless, you know, I don't teach as many hours, but I don't think I'd like that. I like to teach.
Time is the thing I think that's even more limiting than equipment or money.
With our teaching loads and our committee loads and all the other things that we do on campus, we don't end up with very much time. And sometimes I feel like I'm just sort of barely making it from one class to the next. Because, I mean, I wouldn't be in that case if I was the kind of teacher who designed a course at the beginning of the course and then just ran it. Then maybe I wouldn't feel that way. But because I am constantly evaluating what's working, what's not, bringing in input, and I need a lot of time along the way. But I think it would be extremely helpful if the college would recognize the need for a careful evaluation and assessment of classes in a more substantial way than that day-to-day thing. I mean, I would like at some point to be able to have a reduced teaching load.
More time. I think I would do more assessment if I had more time to do it.
Time. Okay. Time. Mm-hmm. And it does take more time to formalize it. And the more formalized you make the process, the more time that's required to be invested in the process.
The discouraging element is the lack of time. I was teaching one of my courses for my project, was part of my teaching load, but collecting the data from students, organizing it, managing it, looking at it, analyzing it, trying to figure out what it meant, took me a quarter and then some beyond the class, and was frankly an absolutely exhausting process.
Here's some advice for the teacher researchers in the audience and the students. First, don't think that your own students or classroom experiences are poor sources of valid research topics. Do believe that your own students and classroom experiences can suggest research topics of interest and relevance to yourself and others. Don't think that the only worthwhile research consists of studies of topics that have never been done before. Do believe that the most useful and practical research often results from studies that adapt or expand previous research. Don't think that only research that radically changes current theory or practice can be termed important. Do believe that research that benefits even one student or one teacher is important. Don't think that you can't begin to do research without a well-developed theory and a carefully designed research plan. Do believe that theories and plans emerge and evolve as you study a problem and attempt to uncover the cause or devise a solution. Research is messy. It's recursive. It rarely goes the way you expect it to go. Classroom research should be tailored by the teacher researcher to fit the instructional situation, the course, the students, the question. It should be continual. And most important, it should help students take more responsibility for their learning. Don't think that you require a doctorate and a course in statistics to do research. I don't have either. Especially for the data collection techniques that I described earlier, an open and inquiring mind is the most important element. Do believe that you need the desire to solve a problem and the perseverance to find a solution, or to discover that there isn't one. But after all this, the most important advice I can give to all the faculty and students at Salt Lake Community College is, don't think too much about research. As Jeanette said, just do it.
I think so. I think it's a disservice to students to not do research. I really think we need to get involved, and I'd like to see us become an institution that's known, you know, around the country. These people not only are, it's not only a teaching institution, it's a teaching research institution where those teachers who teach also do research and also know that what's happening in their classroom is really beneficial. I think sometimes we assume what we're teaching is what we're teaching. In fact, it's not. It reminds me of a story that I told of the little boy who went to first grade and he was all excited. His teacher had spent a whole summer long in a seminar on how to teach mathematics, and she was all excited about teaching mathematics to these first graders. And so when he went and sat down, the teacher said, "We're going to talk a little bit about mathematics," and she had all the boys in the class stand up and said, "This is a set of boys in the class." She explained what that was and had them sit down, and then she had all the girls stand up and explain it was a set of girls in the class. And she had the brown-eyed boys stand up, and there's a set of brown-eyed boys in the class, and all the blue-eyed children stand up, and she went this whole process of explaining sets, and Johnny was just going, "Whoa, this is great, this is wonderful." Well, after it was all over, Johnny went home, and his mom happened to also be a first-grade teacher, had the same workshop, and so when he walked in the house, he said, "Johnny, what did you learn at school today?" She said, "Oh, I learned all about sets." And she'd been shopping, so she pulled a bunch of carrots out. She says, Johnny, is this a set of carrots? I said, I don't know, can they stand that? And so I think sometimes, you know, you never know what you're really teaching until you get that feedback.
I think we're growing up. We used to be allergic to the word research, as if research had no place in a two-year college at all. I think we're way past that.
There are other ways of looking at that research. I would, in some ways, try to deconstruct, I guess, the idea that research is something that only occurs at a university. That research is only something that a person who is specifically trained in research methods and methodologies can do. And that research is already inherently a part of the teaching profession.
When you think you've discovered some kind of little problem and you say to yourself, there's got to be a better way of handling this situation, building a better mousetrap, and so you back up and retreat and say, what can we do better, and go do it. And I guess that's research.
Yeah, I guess what I would do is I would share my own experience. I don't think I would ever presume to tell another faculty member how they ought to do something, but I do think I would tell them how much, whenever I have a really successful teaching day, it's because I listened to what my students were saying the week before. Not directly, I mean, they aren't saying, you know, Helen, change this, do that. But if I'm not listening and responding to what's going on in the classroom, I don't see how I could possibly continue to expand them and explore things with them. It's just, teaching isn't static.
Of the committee for the Distinguished Faculty Award for 1995, I would like to present to Kathy McIntyre this award for Distinguished Faculty Award. And I would also like to thank all of you for being with us today. Thank you. As Kathy has explored the most important issues of teaching, learning, and researching, I'd like to thank the students for joining us, because it is certainly important that both teachers and students realize that we can use the time we do have to be enhanced quality time, the time that we have each moment with our students, with each other as colleagues. And I also would like to note that today is an important time to consider these various issues that Kathy has, because we are nearing the end of a quarter, at which time all of us as teachers and students assess the learning that has occurred during that quarter. And I'd also like to encourage all of the faculty to consider applying by March 31st, 3 p.m. March 31st, to apply for the Distinguished Lectureship for next year, 1966. I have a special request, so think about that. You too can have a chance to be here, working with the instructional technology. At this moment, surveys, which are an important part of observation and data collection, have been passed out to all of you. Take a few minutes to answer those and return them to the ushers at the back of whatever room in which you are seated before you join us at the reception in the Oak Room. Thank you so much, Kathy. And now I'd like Ann Erickson to come up.
Just a very quick concluding word on behalf of the Academic Vice President's Office and all faculty here. I want to add my thanks to Katherine and her thoughtful, provocative presentation. Thanks to both Katherine and to her colleagues who've done a fine job, and I know there are lots of ideas that have been generated here today. Just one last comment. Note that the reception is in the Oak Room, as Marilyn suggested, not as previously advertised. And I want to take note of our colleagues at the South City campus who are have joined us via technology today in the Grand Theater, so that you will know a little research going on here in the college in this experiment today, and also in adjoining rooms here. The reception is here at this campus site. So please join Katherine over there concluding this event. Thanks again. Let's give Katherine one last round of applause.